Okay, colleagues, the final item of business, a member's business debate on motion 3994 in the name of John Mason on Scotland's companies. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put. I would encourage members who wish to participate to press the request to speak buttons or press an R in the chat function. I would also encourage members who are leaving the chamber to do so quietly and quickly. And I call on John Mason to open the debate for around 7 minutes. Mr. Mason.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I'm very grateful to have the chance to have a members' debate in my name today. It does take quite a lot of time to get people to agree with much that I say. This is a subject that's concerned me for quite some time, and if we lose business headquarters and ownership from Scotland, does this not mean that it has a negative effect on the Scottish economy? And does it not mean that at a time of downturn, it is not more likely that a Scottish branch of a business, which is perceived to be far away from the centre, will be closed down if there is apparently overcapacity? We have seen this quite recently with McVitie's in my own constituency, which was floated as a public company many years ago, has suffered from a lack of investment and is now being closed. And this is despite the fact that the Scottish food sector as a whole is doing well. And people around the world are willing to pay a premium for Scottish products. Other biscuit companies like Walker's, Border Biscuits and Tunnocks appear to be doing very well. And a few years ago, when I visited the Faroe Islands, they even had Tunnocks tea cakes in the local shops. But this is a much wider issue. Over the years, we have lost Stackis, Quickfit, Scottish and Newcastle, Bank of Scotland, and we do not even have the name of the Clydesdale Bank on the high street anymore. And right up to date, we are seeing, firstly, Stagecoach, almost taken over by National Express. Even though it was called a merger, it would have been 75% National Express with the HQ down south. Although now it looks like Stagecoach will be owned by German investment company DWS Infrastructure, which at least would mean some HQ functions staying in Scotland. Then again, we have Capricorn, which used to be called Cairn Energy, is looking at being taken over by Tullow Oil. Simon Thompson was chief executive of Capricorn and was asked about having a London HQ. He said, quote, "This is all about creating value for shareholders," unquote. And it is reckoned that if that goes ahead, redundancies of some will be expected to cost some $50 million. Again, we have First Group currently rejecting a bid from I-Squared Capital. Now, I understand the Competitions and Markets Authority was looking into the National Express Stagecoach deal. They are clearly a reserve body, and we would need to consider an equivalent body in the event of independence. But their focus seems to be on competition concerns, with the assumption that mergers and takeovers should go ahead unless there are serious reasons not to do so. I guess I'm just floating some ideas today, but I wonder if we should be reversing that thinking, for example, by assuming that takeovers and mergers should not go ahead unless there are compelling reasons why they should do so, such as a declining market or strong foreign competition.
Thank you, Johnston.
For giving way. And indeed, I think what's one of the interesting things about the point he just raises there is actually there's a lot of academic work and theory showing that actually mergers very often decrease value rather than add to the value. And is that something he thinks that we should give more thought to?
John Mason.
Yes, it was a point I was going to refer to later on, although I may not actually get that far. But the point that a merger or takeover generally does not increase value, but it shifts value often away from the staff, the employees, towards shareholders. Now, of course, shareholders are vital and they should always have a way out when they want or need to sell their shares. But other European countries seem to be better than the UK is at keeping more control of their important businesses. We saw that especially with the Dutch National Railways effectively running ours too. Now, why should that be a good thing? And going further back, Scottish Power was taken over by Iberdrola in 2007, with no benefit that I can see to Scottish workers or energy users. Now, I should probably declare an interest here, as my father spent his whole working life with Scottish Power, or SSEB, as it was previously was, which, as far as I can see, was a successful company. Why did it need to be taken over? Now, of course, electricity should never have been privatised in the first place, and once you float a business on the stock exchange, you lose control. Anyone can then buy and sell it, so you're at the mercy of those who want to make a quick buck. And as a general rule, we know the short term overrules the longer term. But I'm not saying that public ownership is always a success. British Airways was not that successful while nationalised, nor was British Rail or, in the car industry, British Leyland. But Scottish Power, Scottish Water, Lothian Buses and others have been broadly good organisations in public ownership. I actually recently realised that the water and sewage systems in every country in the world are in public ownership, except in England and Wales. And of course, there are other models of ownership too. Family businesses like Scottish Leather Group are one of the top leather businesses in the world. And the Scottish Family Business Association pushes for continuation of family-owned businesses or models other than flotation. Employee ownership is another model, such as John Lewis Partnership, and now West Brewery, again in my constituency. Social enterprises and cooperatives are other options, and I note that Paul Sweeney has a motion on Co-op Fortnight, and I was happy to put my name to that. But does it really matter who owns the business and where the HQ is? Some would say that profitability, productivity and efficiency are the only things that matter. Yet the HQ function also means the top paid jobs and the taxes they pay will be in the home country. Auditors, lawyers, consultants and other suppliers will tend to be there as well. And there is usually the spin-off of local hotels and restaurants benefiting too. We see that in our own case in the Scottish Parliament, as many of us use Edinburgh hotels, restaurants and pubs during the week. And I would just finish with a few points and quotes made in academic and newspaper articles over a number of years. Scott Wright in the Herald on the 2nd of June talked about the loss of headquarters being a loss of prestige and the global reputation of Scotland as a place where a business of significant size can be built and, crucially, can remain. But he says arguably not a lot can be done to stop a takeover. Boards have to maximise shareholder value. Again in the Herald on 17th June, Colin McLean writes about how change of corporate control in the UK is easier than in other European countries, and the potential for headquarters to move or activity to be relocated, and too often takeover promises have later been set aside. Both Ireland and Denmark have major listed companies on a scale well beyond Scotland's sector. This takeover trend is concerning, he points out. So to come to a conclusion and to finish, I have to say on a more positive note, it was good to see that Inverness-based Carlton Bingo with 209 staff is becoming Scotland's largest employee-owned firm. Well done to them. Maybe I'm raising more questions than giving answers today. However, as I said, this is a subject that's concerned me for a while, and I think we as a Parliament should be looking at it going forward. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr Mason. I now call Liz Smith, who will be followed by Paul McLennan in around 4 minutes, Ms Smith.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I thank John Mason for bringing what I think is an important debate to the Chamber, because it goes without saying that all of us in this place, irrespective of our political views, are rightly very proud of our Scottish companies and their Scottish heritage. Mr Mason has spoken about several key companies with very distinguished and long-standing Scottish heritage, with names renowned across the world. Now, sometimes there are sound economic reasons, often related to economies of scale, as to why some Scottish companies may wish to give up some control of their assets. But there are clearly trends of companies in Scotland giving up significant control of their businesses to foreign firms, and I can understand why Mr Mason has concern about that. So it's therefore of the utmost importance that we work together in this chamber to provide support where it's needed and ensure that as many companies are able to remain independently competitive. Over my 15 years as an MSP, I've worked very closely over a range of issues for companies like Stagecoach in my own Perth region. Most of my interactions with Stagecoach representatives have been entirely productive, and their willingness to engage constructively with me and other representatives and my constituents has always been greatly appreciated. Moreover, I was relieved to hear, as I think Mr Mason mentioned, that the new deal between DWS and Stagecoach means that the headquarters will now remain in Perth, which would not have been the case if the previous National Express merger had taken place. Many of the services that Stagecoach run across Mid-Scotland and Fife are absolute lifelines for elderly constituents attending medical appointments, for example, and for students attending their educational establishments. So I think it's very important that we continue to support a company like Stagecoach through this transition so that these lifeline services continue to operate as frequently as possible. Similarly, I can commend the work of John Menzies, most especially as it's had to deal with the exigencies of the pandemic. The aviation sector across the world bore the brunt of the government's, all governments, not any specific government, policies to stop the spread of the virus. And it's obviously very worrying, but somewhat unsurprising, that the companies in this sector will have to make significant compromises that would not have been the case in normal circumstances. A year ago, I was one of the members of this Parliament, some of them present this evening, who stood outside this Parliament when various representatives from the aviation sector came to tell us exactly what their plight involved. And it wasn't funny, to be honest, listening to some of their stories about their experiences. And so I wasn't surprised when the news came through of the full takeover of the business by Kuwait's National Aviation Services. So while it goes without saying that the examples of the loss of independent control in Scottish businesses is disappointing and in some cases very worrying, I think we have to also ask ourselves, and Mr Mason was asking us to ask these questions, about why it is that Scottish businesses feel the need to relocate and in some cases to forfeit considerable control to foreign investors. Like other colleagues, I've had many meetings with business leaders throughout the COVID-19 pandemic, and I've also attended several roundtables with key businesses, one of them just this morning. And I think it's very clear that business confidence in many sectors is weak. Some even feel that policymakers do not see them as a priority, and they worry about the future of the Scottish economy. And Mr Mason, Daniel Johnson, sits on the same finance committee that I do, and we know only too well what the in-depth analysis of the main forecasters is showing. And it's not a happy picture, let's be honest about that. Businesses are facing rising costs, serious recruitment issues and rising debt. But as well as this, there are longer-term structural problems in the labour market, serious productivity issues and skills shortages. Businesses want as much stability and certainty as possible. And I think that's something the Cabinet Secretary herself said two budgets ago. But at the moment, they don't have either. Plus, of course, they do now have another referendum threat and the turmoil that that will create. None of these things is helpful to Scottish business to retain that discrete heritage that we all want to see, but also its economic viability. And I think we should worry about that.
Thank you very much, Ms Smith. I now call Paul McLennan to be followed by Daniel Johnson again, around 4 minutes. Mr McLennan.
Thank you, Deputy President Officer. Can I thank John Mason for bringing forward this member's debate tonight? And can I first of all share his concern about the headquarters functions of Stagecoach and John Menzies may be lost. Those companies are well known in Scotland and have had a strong presence for many years. Now, I worked for the Bank of Scotland for 20 years from 1990 to 2010 and was working at the time of the so-called merger with the Halifax when it became HBOS. Then again, through Lloyds, decision-making was changed overnight, and I literally mean overnight, and this was very noticeable. It's very sad now to see the Mound only operates as a museum and a corporate meeting venue. Now, according to the Insider magazine in April this year, the top 10 companies in Scotland were SSE, Scottish Power, Bank of Scotland, Aviva, Royal Bank of Scotland, Virgin Money, Arnold Clark, Weir Group and Chivas Brothers. Other notable companies included Scottish Widows, First Group and Aberdeen. These were all companies that started in Scotland. How many are still headquarters in Scotland? And more importantly, where are investment decisions made? So how do we compare with countries similar in population? Let's look at two of our neighbours, Denmark and Ireland, roughly the same population as Scotland, and noticeably both still in the EU. Top six companies in Denmark are Maersk, Danske Bank, Novo Orsted, Carlsberg and Vestas. The market capitalisation of these companies is $285 billion, with assets under control of $882 billion. The top 10 companies in Denmark made a combined profit of $16.3 billion. In Ireland, market capitalisation of 10 top companies is $482 billion, with market capitalisation of $452 billion. Again, top companies and top 10 companies in Ireland with a combined profit of $19.6 billion. Top 10 companies. Irish companies included Eilead Irish, Ryanair and Townlake Constructions. Now, why is this important? The Danish corporation tax rate is 22%. That's a boost of $3.6 billion to the Danish Treasury alone of the top 10 companies. The Irish corporation tax is 12.5%, a boost of $2.5 billion, again, only the top 10 companies. This is a prize that Scotland could have. So what do we need to do in Scotland to first retain headquarters in Scotland and attract further investment into Scotland? We need the levers of an independent country like Denmark and Ireland. We need macroeconomic powers, and we need to be back in the EU. So what are these powers? ability to set interest rates, ability to set corporation tax, tax relief for investors, borrowing powers to support and structure, and crucially, investment in research and development. So do we have the ability to attract investment into Scotland? Ernst & Young, in a survey published a few weeks ago on the FDI front relative to other parts of the UK and to other countries and elsewhere in Europe, Scotland outpaced UK-wide progress significantly. Ernst & Young declared Scotland had made great strides as a destination for FDI in 2021, and its survey revealed that the nation's attractiveness rating from potential future investments had hit a record. They stated, and I quote, "Our findings suggest that the outlook for Scotland's FDI is exceptionally bright. Scotland achieved a 14% rise in the number of inward investment projects to 122. Putting a 1-point increase in the UK in the shade, and Europe 5.4% rise in the numbers in the shade also. The increase in inward investment projects won by Scotland last year was the fourth consecutive annual rise. Ernst & Young again stated the past year has seen Scotland continue to make great strides as a destination for FDI, meaning it can look to the future with even greater confidence. Scotland's record levels of attractiveness and is underpinned by investors' rising perceptions. The importance of such investment should not be underestimated. The FDI often brings with it very high-value jobs. Such projects are R&D-led and can involve collaborations with Scottish universities. President Officer, to conclude, the UK stewardship of the economy and its control of macroeconomic levels hinder Scotland attracting companies to HQ in Scotland. Scotland needs to be like Denmark and Ireland to have the macroeconomic levers to attract investment and attract business to headquarters in Scotland. Denmark and Ireland do it successfully. Why not Scotland? Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. McLennan. And I call Daniel Johnson for around 4 minutes, Mr. Johnson.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I'm really pleased that John Mason brought forward this debate, because I think it does ask the sort of important questions we need to ask, and indeed the ones that Mr. Mason posed, because I think it does matter where our business and our industry is owned. And in part, there is a sentimental reason, and I think Mr. Mason alluded to those, that when we see companies like John Mingus, as my mother always told me to pronounce it, not John Menzies, or indeed others, go into foreign ownership, it is sad. But I think there's actually important reasons as well, is that when those companies' decision-making is made elsewhere, where they seek to make their investment decisions, when those decisions are being made in another place by other people, I mean, I think there is intuitively more likely to be reasons that they will not invest necessarily in the place where their acquired business rests, although they might do. And indeed, almost, I agree with a lot of what Mr. McLennan said. I think there's questions about the macroeconomic policies, but actually, also, I think his contribution, I think, also hit upon one of the tensions, because while he was juxtaposing those downsides, he was contrasting with foreign direct investment. And I would just gently point out that FBIT of FDI, we are in a global marketplace. And I think regardless of our different views on the Constitution, actually at the heart of this is how do we strike that balance between indigenous growth, I think, which we can all agree in, that we have to ensure that we have an environment where businesses are created and grown here, but also acknowledging that it is a global economy, whether we like it or not. You know, and in some ways, there are many people, perhaps, you know, my benches aren't full at the moment, who might be alarmed at some of the things I'm saying, but we can't undo the global economy. We can't go back to the 1970s. We can't put up the walls. So the example I like to think about is Wolfson Electronics, which was very successful, founded in the 1980s. And every time I pass their office building, I wonder, you know, did it need to be like this, that they got bought by Cirrus? But then actually, when you look at it, there's still 300 jobs in Edinburgh employed by them. If you look at their job sites, there are jobs being advertised for senior semiconductor engineers. So there is a balance to be struck. But ultimately, I do think we need to question what we need to do to retain more businesses owned in Scotland. I think part of that, I think we do need, I think, to examine companies law. I think we make it too easy. In France, they blocked the acquisition of Danone, a yogurt manufacturer, in 2004 on the basis that that was of strategic interest to France. That's not the sort of thing that you see happening here. But I think we do need to, I think, question that. I would highlight on the fact that mergers don't tend to create value. Now, I think we do need to, I think, adhere to the market. I don't think we can just block things outright, but I think there is an issue there. But I also think we need to look at our own policies. Do we always use the right vehicles? Could we use golden shares when we're doing our co-investment through Scottish Enterprise and Scottish National Investment Bank? Could we use joint venture structures so that, yes, we attract the outside capital, but we actually build something here as well. That's something that is used in other countries. And I do wonder whether or not there were possibilities with Scotland or other future infrastructure where that joint venture means that we can build infrastructure, but at least we retain, at least in part, the ownership here. I think we do also need to look at our wider policy landscape, because when I'm talking to businesses, I know there is a concern that we are not necessarily retaining those, you know, such as life sciences, and there's a very active concern whether we're retaining life science businesses. And the issues there aren't the big ones Mr. McLennan was pointing to, but there are things like planning. You know, there are things like skills policy. There are things that are absolutely within our control here. So I think there are some really good questions that have been raised. I think there are some things that are definitely out with the Scottish Parliament, but there are also things here. But ultimately, this is about growing businesses, which is about growing jobs and growing wages, which ultimately, while economic policy is complicated, I think it does boil down to those simple things. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Johnson. I now call on Ivan McKee to respond to the debate. Minister, for around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And it's a real pleasure, this debate. It's a shame there's not perhaps more members that wanted to take part in it, but the contributions have been excellent by and large. And I thank John Mason for bringing this debate and pursuing it in such a constructive manner. I'd like to start off, first of all, by being clear about the Scottish Government's objective for our economy, which is to strengthen our domestic economy. And our recently published National Strategy for Economic Transformation is absolutely focused on the actions to make the Scottish economy and Scottish businesses more prosperous, more productive and more internationally competitive. And the Scottish Government, alongside our enterprise agencies and partners, are prioritising creating a business environment in which homegrown businesses in key sectors can grow, develop and compete for global market share. And to do that, we have to create that environment in which businesses can thrive. We recognise that investment around company growth and scaling can be difficult and limited in a small Scottish market with few players, and Scottish companies often access international investment to support their growth ambitions. And we're therefore working hard to create the economic conditions where Scottish companies can realise the benefits of keeping control of their operations in Scotland. Scottish Government-backed investment funds are designed to fill key gaps in the continuum of growth capital to enable Scottish companies to scale. And at the same time, this creates a busier ecosystem of private investors in Scotland, affording Scottish businesses more opportunities for growth here in Scotland. And the strategic direction behind that and the policy action we're taking is well articulated in our Global Capital Investment Plan. And through our enterprise agencies, we provide a wide range of funding and support for Scottish businesses, including R&D grants, the Scottish Co-Investment Fund and the Scottish Loan Scheme. And this provides domestic companies with an opportunity to achieve their growth ambitions in Scotland, as well as increase productivity and enhance efficiency. However, funding growth should be appropriate for the type of business, and it's not a one-size-fits-all. And that can come from a variety of sources, both private and public and domestic, as well as international. And what is important is that business gets the right investment and support they need while we build an open and effective economy. Acquisitions, when right for a business, give companies access to global technology, talent and markets and support their growth ambitions. And just because a company is acquired does not mean that there is no longer a focus on Scottish operations. Often it can mean that the acquired business is afforded the opportunity to flourish. In fact, Scotland outperforms other countries on measures of business performance after acquisitions, and there is little difference in inward investment acquisition rates between Scotland and other small European nations. Clydespace, for example, a Scottish start-up which kick-started the space sector here in Scotland, was acquired by Swedish AAC in 2019, and the acquisition has seen continued investment in Scotland, providing Clydespace with access to new investment, skills and global markets. And that investment is a catalyst for growing the talent base here in Scotland in the space sector. And another example that John Mason will be familiar with, Soapworks in my own constituency, was a business that struggled for many years and had many difficulties operating as a private company. It was acquired by Colombian group Dabon two or three years ago, and has since gone from strength to strength for their investment, access to new markets through Dabon's global networks, and a much more competitive business, saving more than 100 jobs as a consequence. I think the Clydespace example in particular illustrates the indirect effect acquisitions can have on our economy, with international investments delivering a wide range of benefits, including improving our reputation, Scotland's reputation in certain key sectors, space is one, life science and many others. And it also helps secure investment to supply chains in Scotland and unlocks the learning and experience for business leaders on how to grow their businesses. And it's also worth noting the substantial financial contribution mergers and acquisitions make to the Scottish economy. In 2021 alone, $2.8 billion in capital was raised from external investors. But it's also worth pointing out that this is a two-way street. Scottish companies who look to grow their businesses abroad can do so. In order for them to grow to an international scale, they often acquire companies in target markets internationally. Earlier this year, Glasgow-based packaging distributor McFarland Group acquired Pacman, a German business, as part of their growth strategy, and that will help them move the Scottish-based firm expand into European markets, illustrating the importance of truly international economies. Wood and Weir Group, both substantial Scottish businesses, have made significant acquisitions internationally over the years. Indeed, Stagecoach, that's been mentioned several times in this debate, made acquisitions in Canada and the US and indeed in Poland through the course of their growth trajectory. So it's very much important to recognise that that is a two-way street. Our current approach to creating an open, outward-looking, internationally-facing economy requires balance, a point made very well by Daniel Johnston. And the best investment ecosystems contain a diverse range of sources of capital, and mergers and acquisitions provide a key form of investment for fast-growing Scottish companies. And the point Daniel Johnston also made about joint ventures is something very well made, and they have a key role to play in many scenarios. Members will also be aware that the power to regulate corporate transactions, including the ability to restrict changes in ownership where it is in the public interest to do so, is of course reserved to UK government and entities such as BEIS and the Competition and Markets Authority, the CMA, who I met recently to discuss these very issues. The Scottish Government, of course, has no legal power to intercede in scenarios where decisions are made that do not align with Scottish policy priorities, and as a part of the UK, Scottish ministers have limited ability to protect, encourage, maintain and grow our desired well-being economy. Additional constitutional powers would, of course, enable us to make decisions that are tailored to Scottish business needs, and in an independent Scotland, we would have more levers and resources at our disposal to support Scottish businesses and the Scottish economy, a point that Paul McLellan made very, very well. So through the delivery of our national strategy for economic transformation, the Scottish Government is working hard to ensure Scottish businesses have access to the right support, including capital to grow their businesses. We are focusing on the actions which can be taken within current constitutional arrangements to transform Scotland's economy, and we will continue to support our businesses and the individuals in upskilling, as well as to utilise new digital technologies and be creating a world-class entrepreneurial nation that is productive and innovative. Scotland's businesses will have the best possible environment to thrive and grow here in Scotland. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting of Parliament.